and Claymont, Delaware.
It was a neat place to grow up. I mean, we thought it was, and still do, think it's completely normal. Four kids, three bedrooms, mom and dad, and of the probably 16 years I lived in that house, there was a relative, at least 14 of those years, living with us full time. My parents never doubted for a second I could be president or vice president, but there's this notion that nobody is better than you. You're no better than anyone else, but nobody's better than you, honey. And in this country, you can be anything you want to be.
And I think that sense of optimism is what he feels for America.
His parents taught him the fundamental truths that make this country special. Basic beliefs that have defined what it has meant to be middle class for generations.
Middle class wasn't a number. It wasn't your net worth. It was more a value set. It's the idea that everyone in this country who works at it can do well, who can own a home, not rent it, be able to live in a safe neighborhood, send their kid to school, help take care of their parents, maybe save enough that they can take care of themselves and not have to rely on their children. That's what this is all about.
But for too many middle-class families, this dream is falling out of reach. The pain of the Great Recession has cut deep.
The longest walk a parent can make is up a short flight of stairs, up to their child's bedroom, to sit on the edge of the bed and say, honey, I'm sorry, but you can't play in the Little League team this summer, and or you can't sing in St. Anne's Choir, or you can't, go to Roosevelt High School. I lost my job. We've got to move. My dad made that walk. Think how many people have made some version of that walk all across America. And they're not looking for a handout. They're just looking for a shot. Just a shot to get back in the game. And I think we owe them that shot.
Giving the middle class a shot has been the cause of this White House. From the moment they took the oath of office, the challenges have been enormous. For this president and vice president, it has been a partnership forged in fire.
It's turned out to be a singular opportunity to be able to work with a guy like Barack Obama, because we trust each other. It's a completely candid relationship. I asked him why he wanted me, and he said to help him govern. And so it's been very rewarding, but it's been most rewarding watching him. This guy has an incredible amount of character. He's a backbone like a ramrod. He makes his judgments based upon what he thinks is good for the country. The last questions he asks are the political consequences of it.
Joe has been a great partner and a great vice president. He cares about the middle class. He knows what it's like to struggle, and he's carried that passion to the White House.
Every step of the way, they have met the challenge. Preventing an economic collapse, rescuing the auto industry, passing historic health care reform, eliminating Bin Laden, ending the war in Iraq. And through it all, they have put the interests of the nation first.
Really and truly, Barack and I are about growing this economy from the middle out. Because when you do it that way, everybody does well. Poor folks have a ladder up. There's a way into the middle class, those who are striving to get in the middle class. And the wealthy do very well, because the middle class have money in their pockets. They can go out and purchase things that make the economy grow. It not only is sort of the American way, it's also economically the best way to grow a country. Give them a tax system that's basically fair. Give their kids an opportunity for an education. Provide an environment where they can flourish.
Maybe it's because he's never forgotten where he came from that he's never lost sight of where we need to go.
He has such a sense of justice and fairness to him. And I think that makes him fight even harder for people.
Maybe it's because he's known loss and pain in his own life that he's never been blind to the suffering of others.
I think that's one of the things that Joe has that a lot of people don't have, the sense of intuition. He intuitively feels someone's pain. He did know what it feels like to lose a wife and then the unspeakable, to lose a child. And I think that's why people connect with him.
He's always shown that he's been a man that supports the working class.
He really cares for you.
He's absolutely here for us. He's listening.
Yes, he is. I'm going to get a chocolate cone. Here, Roger.
Hey, Roger. This is Joe Biden.
Maybe it's because he's never doubted the American people that he's never doubted America's future.
It's never been a safe bet to bet against America. I know I get criticized for saying that to foreign leaders, but I will not stop saying it. It's never been a good bet to bet against America.
We're in a fight for the middle class, and there's nobody I'd rather have in that fight with me than Joe Biden.
He's the husband of a teacher who knows teachers should be lifted up, not torn down. He's the son of an auto man who never doubted the American auto industry would once again roar. He's the author of the Violence Against Women Act, who's had the courage to stand against the abuse of power his whole career. He's the father of an Iraq war veteran who believes our one sacred obligation is to take care of those who have served this nation.
I can say with absolute certitude, I am more optimistic about America's chances today than I have been my entire life.
Grit, determination, resilience, optimism. That's been the story of America, the story of ordinary people with extraordinary courage, overcoming extraordinary obstacles, and always, always moving towards a better day. Joe Biden knows that story. He's lived it. Our Vice President, Joe Biden.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Vice President of the United States, Joe Biden.
I want you to know that Bo and Hunt and Ashton and I, we're so incredibly proud of you, kid. You know, we admire the way when every single solitary young person, and they're not all young, walk into your classroom, you not only teach them, you give them confidence. You give me confidence. And the passion she brings to trying to ease the burden on the families of our warriors. Jilly, they know you understand them, and that makes a gigantic difference. And folks, I tell you what, it was worth the trip to hear my wife say what I've never heard her say before. She's always loved me. If that's the case, why in the heck did it take five times of asking you? And that's true, five times. I don't know what it would have done, kiddo, had you on that fifth time said no. I love you. You're the love of my life and the life of my love. We've got three incredible kids. And Bo, I want to thank you for putting my name and nomination to be Vice President of the United States.
I accept. With great honor and pleasure, I accept. Thank you.
you, my fellow Democrats. And I say to my fellow Americans, 4 years ago, a battered nation turned away from the failed policies of the past and turned to a leader who they knew would lift our nation out of the crisis. A journey we haven't finished yet. We know we still have more to do. But today, I say to my fellow citizens, in the face of the deepest economic crisis in our lifetime, this generation of Americans has proven itself as worthy as any generation before us. For we possess that same grit, that same determination, that same courage that has always defined what it means to be an American, has always defined all of you. Together, we're on a mission. We're on a mission to move this nation forward from doubt and downturn to promise and prosperity. A mission I guarantee you we will complete. A mission we will complete. Folks, tonight what I really want to do is tell you about my friend Barack Obama. No one could tell it as well or as eloquently as Michelle. As you did last night, Michelle, on Monday night. But I know him, to state the obvious, from a different perspective. I know him, and I want to show you the character of a leader who had what it took when the American people literally stood on the brink of a new depression. A leader who has what it takes to lead us over the next 4 years to a future as great as our people. I want to take you inside the White House to see the president as I see him every day, because I don't see him in sound bites. I walk 30 paces down the hall into the Oval Office, and I see him, I watch him in action. 4 years ago, the middle class was already losing ground. And then the bottom fell out. The financial crisis hit like a sledgehammer on all the people I grew up with. You remember the headlines. You saw some of them in the previews. Highlight: highest job losses in 60 years. Headlines: economy on the brink. Markets plummet worldwide. From the very moment President Obama sat behind the desk resolute in the Oval Office, He knew he had not only to restore the confidence of a nation, but he had to restore the confidence of the whole world. And he also knew that one false move could bring a run on the banks or a credit collapse to put another several million people out of work. America and the world needed a strong president with a steady hand and with the judgment and vision to see us through. Day after day, night after night, I sat beside him as he made one gutsy decision after the other to stop the slide and reverse it. I watched him stand up to intense pressure and stare down enormous, enormous challenges, the consequences of which were awesome. But most of all, I got to see firsthand what drove this man, his profound concern for the average American. He knew that no matter how tough the decisions he had to make were in that Oval Office, He knew that families all over America, sitting at their kitchen tables, were literally making decisions for their family that were equally as consequential. You know, Barack and I, we've been through a lot together in these 4 years, and we learned about one another, a lot about one another. And one of the things I learned about Barack is the enormity of his heart, and I think he learned about me the depth of my loyalty to him. And there's another thing that has bound us together these past 4 years. We had a pretty good idea what all those families, all you Americans in trouble, were going through. In part because our own families had gone through similar struggles. Barack, as a young man, had to sit at the end of his mother's hospital bed and watch her fight with her insurance company at the very same time she was fighting for her life. When I was a young kid in third grade, I remember my dad coming up the stairs of my grandpa's house where we were living, sitting at the end of my bed and saying, "Joey, I'm going to have to leave for a while. Go down to Wilmington, Delaware with Uncle Frank. The good job's down there, honey. And a little while, I'll be able to send for you and Mom and Jimmy and Val, and everything's going to be fine." For the rest of our lives, my sister and my brothers, for the rest of our life, my dad never failed to remind us that a job is about a lot more than a paycheck. It's about your dignity. It's about respect. It's about your place in the community. It's about being able to look your child in the eye and say, "Honey, it's going to be okay," and mean it, and know it's true. When Barack and I were growing up, there was an implicit understanding in America that if you took responsibility, you'd get a fair shot at a better life. And the values behind that bargain were the values that shaped both of us and many, many of you. And today, those same values are Barack's guiding star. Folks, I've watched him. He has never wavered. He never, never backs down. He always steps up, and he always asks in every one of those critical meetings the same fundamental question: how is this going to affect the average American? How is this going to affect people's lives? That's what's inside this man. That's what makes him tick. That's who he is. Because of the decisions he has made and the incredible strength of the American people, America has turned the corner. The worst job loss since the Great Depression. We've since created 4.5 million private sector jobs in the past 29 months. Look, folks. President Obama and Governor Romney, they're both loving husbands. They're both devoted fathers. But let's be straight. They bring a vastly different vision and a vastly different value set to the job. And tonight, although you've heard people talk about it, I want to talk about two things from a slightly different perspective, from my perspective. I'd like to focus on two crises and show you the character of the leadership that each man will bring to this job. Because, as I said, I've had a ringside seat. The first of these A lot's been talked about. And God love Jennifer Granholm. Wasn't she great? Wasn't she great? I love Jennifer. But the first story I want to talk to you about is the rescue of the automobile industry. And let me tell you from this man's ringside seat, let me tell you about how Barack Obama saved more than a million American jobs. In the first days that we took office, General Motors and Chrysler were literally on the verge of liquidation. If the president didn't act, if he didn't act immediately, there wouldn't be any industry left to save. So we sat hour after hour in the Oval Office. Michelle remembers what he must have thought when he came back upstairs. We sat hour after hour. We listened to senators, congressmen, outside advisors, even some of our own advisors. We listened to them to say some of the following things. They said, well, we shouldn't step up. The risks were too high. The outcome was too uncertain. And the president, he patiently sat there and he listened. But he didn't see it the way they did. He understood something they didn't get, and one of the reasons I love him. He understood that this wasn't just about cars. It was about the people who built and made those cars. And about the America those people built. In those meetings, In those meetings, I often thought about my dad. My dad was an automobile man. He would have been one of those guys all the way down the line, not in the factory floor, not along the supply chain, but one of those guys who were selling American cars to American people. I thought about what this crisis would have meant for the mechanics and the secretaries and the salespeople who my dad managed for over 35 years. And I know for certain that my dad, were he here today, he'd be fighting like heck for the president, because the president fought to save the jobs of those people my dad cared so much about. Ladies and gentlemen, my dad respected Barack Obama, and would have respected Barack Obama had he been around, for having had the guts to stand up for the automobile industry when so many others just were prepared to walk away. You know, when I look back on the president's decision, I think of another son of another automobile man, Mitt Romney. Mitt Romney grew up in Detroit. My dad managed, his dad ran an entire automobile company, American Motors. Yes, what I don't understand is, in spite of that, he was willing to let Detroit go bankrupt. Look, I don't think he's a bad guy. I'm sure he grew up loving cars as much as I did. But what I don't understand, what I don't think he understood, I don't think he understood that saving the automobile worker, saving the industry, what it meant to all of America, not just auto workers. I think he saw it the Bain way. Now, I mean this sincerely. I think he saw it in terms of balance sheets and write-offs. Folks, the Bain way may bring your firm the highest profits, but it's not the way to lead our country from the highest office. When things hung in the balance, I mean literally hung in the balance, the president understood this was about a lot more than the automobile industry. This was about restoring America's pride. He understood in his gut what it would mean to leave a million people without hope or work if he didn't act. And he also knew, he intuitively understood the message it would have sent around the world if the United States gave up on an industry that helped put America on the map in the first place. Conviction, resolve, Barack Obama, that's what saved the automobile industry. Conviction, resolve, Barack Obama. Look, you heard my friend John Kerry. This president has shown the same resolve, the same steady hand in his role as commander-in-chief. Look, which brings me to the next illustration I want to tell you about, the next crisis he had to face. In 2008, before he was president, Barack Obama made a promise to the American people. He said, if we have Bin Laden in our sights, we will take him out. He went on to say, that has to be our biggest national security priority. Look, Barack understood that the search for Bin Laden was about a lot more than taking a monstrous leader off the battlefield. It was about so much more than that. It was about righting an unspeakable wrong. It was about healing an unbearable wound, a nearly unbearable wound in America's heart. And he also knew the message we had to send around the world. If you attack innocent Americans, we will follow you to the end of the earth. Look. Most of all. Most of all, President Obama had an unyielding faith in the capacity and the capability of our special forces, literally the finest warriors in the history of the world. The finest warriors in the history of the world. So we sat. We sat originally, only five of us. We sat in the Situation Room beginning in the fall of the year before. We listened, we talked, we heard, and he listened to the risks and reservations about the raid. He asked again the tough questions. He listened to the doubts that were expressed. But when Admiral McRaven looked him in the eye and said, sir, we can get this job done. I sit next to him. I looked at your husband, and I knew at that moment he had made his decision. And his response was decisive. He said, do it, and justice was done. Folks, Governor Romney didn't see things that way. When he was asked about Bin Laden in 2007, here's what he said. He said, it's not worth moving heaven and earth and spending billions of dollars just to catch one person. But he was wrong. He was wrong. Because if you understood that America's heart had to be healed, you would have done exactly exactly what the president did, and you would move heaven and earth to hunt him down and to bring him to justice. Look, 4 years ago, 4 years ago, only thing missing at this convention this year is my mom. 4 years ago, my mom was still with us, sitting up in the stadium in Denver. I quoted her, one of her favorite expressions. She used to say to all her children, she said, "Joey, bravery resides in every heart, and the time will come when it must be summoned." Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you what I think you already know, but I watch it up close. Bravery resides in the heart of Barack Obama, and time again, I witnessed him summon it. This man has courage in his soul, compassion in his heart, and a spine of steel. And because of all the actions he took, because of the calls he made, because of the determination of American workers and the unparalleled bravery of our special forces, we can now proudly say what you've heard me say the last 6 months. Osama bin Laden is dead and General Motors is alive. That's right. One man. We know we have more work to do. We know we're not there yet. But not a day has gone by in the last 4 years when I haven't been grateful as an American that Barack Obama is our president, because he always has the courage to make the tough decision. Speaking of tough calls, last week, we heard at the Republican convention, we heard our opponents pledge that they too had the courage to make the tough calls. That's what they said. But folks, in case you didn't notice, I say to my fellow Americans, in case you didn't notice, they didn't have the courage to tell you what calls they'd make. They never mentioned any of that. Hey, Mrs. Robinson, you watched from home, I guess, from the White House. You heard them talk so much about how they cared so much about Medicare, how much they wanted to preserve it. That's what they told you. But let's look at what they didn't tell you. What they didn't tell you is that the plan they have already put down on paper would immediately cut benefits for more than 30 million seniors already on Medicare. What they didn't tell you is the plan they're proposing would cause Medicare to go bankrupt by 2016. And what they really didn't tell you is if you want to know, they're not for preserving Medicare at all. They're for a new plan. It's called voucher care. Look, folks, that's not courage. That's not even truthful. That's not even truthful. In Tampa, they talk with great urgency about the nation's debt and the need to act now. But not once, not one single time did they tell you that they rejected every plan put forward by us, by the bipartisan Simpson-Bowles Commission they referenced, or by any other respected group to reduce the national debt. They were not for any of them. Why? Because they're not prepared to do anything about the debt if it contained even $1, I'm not exaggerating, even $1 or 1 cent in new taxes for millionaires. Folks, that's not courage. and that's not fair. Look, look. In a sense, this can be reduced to a single notion. The two men seeking to lead this country over the next 4 years, as I said at the outset, have fundamentally different visions and completely different value set. Governor Romney believes in this global economy, it doesn't matter much where American companies invest and put their money or where they create jobs. As a matter of fact, in his budget proposal, in his tax proposal, he calls for a new tax. It's called a territorial tax, which the experts have looked at, and they acknowledge it will create 800,000 new jobs, all of them overseas, all of them. And what I found fascinating, the most fascinating thing I found last week, was when Governor Romney said that as president, he would take a jobs tour. Well, with his support for outsourcing, it's going to have to be a foreign trip. It will. Look, President Obama knows that creating jobs in America, keeping jobs in America, bringing jobs back to America is what the president's job is all about. That's what presidents do, or at least supposed to do. Folks, Governor Romney believes it's okay to raise taxes on middle classes by $2,000 in order to pay for another trillion-dollar tax cut for the very wealthy. President Obama knows that there's nothing decent or fair about asking people with more to do less and with less to do more. Governor Romney believes that kids like our dreamers, those immigrant children who were brought to America's shores through no fault of their own, he thinks they're a drag on the American economy. President Obama believes that even though those dreamers, those kids, didn't choose to come here, they have chosen to do right by America, and it's time for us to do right by them. Of equal pay in terms of a company's bottom line. President Obama, he knows that making sure our daughters get the same pay for the same jobs as our son is every father's bottom line. I kind of expected all that from them, but one thing truly perplexed me at their convention. The thing that perplexed me most was this idea they kept talking about the culture of dependency. They seem to think you create a culture of dependency when you provide a bright, young, qualified kid from a working-class family a loan to get to college, or when you provide a job training program in a new industry for a dad who lost his job because it was outsourced. Folks, that's not how we look at it. That's not how America's ever looked at it. What he doesn't understand is all these men and women are looking for is a chance, just a chance to acquire the skills to be able to provide for their families so they can once again hold their heads high and lead independent lives with dignity. That's all they're looking for. Look. And it literally amazes me they don't understand that. You know, I told you at the outset, the choice is stark. Two different visions, two different value sets. But at its core, the difference is able to reduce to be a fundamental difference. You see, most Americans, have incredible faith in the decency and hard work of the American people. And we know what has made this country. It's the American people. As I mentioned at the outset, 4 years ago, we were hit hard. You saw your retirement accounts drained, the equity in your homes vanished, jobs lost or on the line. But what did you do as Americans? What you've always done. You didn't lose faith. You fought back. You didn't give up. You got up. You're the ones. The American people, you're the ones. You're the reason why we are still better positioned than any country in the world to lead the 21st century. You never quit on America. And you deserve a president who will never quit on you. There's one more thing. One more thing our Republican opponents are just dead wrong about. America is not in decline. America is not in decline. I've got news for Governor Romney and Congressman Ryan. Gentlemen, it never makes sense. It's never been a good bet to bet against the American people. Never. In a moment, we're going to hear from a man whose whole life is a testament to the power of that dream and whose presidency is the best hope to secure that dream for our children. For you see, we see a future. We really, honest to God, do. We see a future where everyone, rich and poor, does their part and has a part. A future where we depend more on clean energy from home and less on oil from abroad. A future where we're number one in the world again in college graduation. A future where we promote the private sector, not the privileged sector. And a future where women once again control their own choices, their destiny, and their own health care. It's in our DNA where no one is forced to live in the shadows of intolerance. Folks, we see a future where America leads not only by the example of our power, but by the power of our example, where we bring our troops home from Afghanistan just as we proudly did from Iraq. A future where we fulfill the only truly sacred obligation we have as a nation. The only truly sacred obligation we have is to prepare those who we send to war and care for them when they come home from war. And tonight, I want to acknowledge, as we should every night, the incredible debt we owe to the families of those 6,473 fallen angels and those 49,746 wounded, thousands critically, thousands who will need our help for the rest of their lives. Folks, We must never, ever forget their sacrifice and always keep them in our care and in our prayers. My fellow Americans, we now find ourselves at the hinge of history. And the direction we turn is not figuratively, it's literally in your hands. It has been a truly great honor to serve you and to serve with Barack, who has always stood up with you for the past 4 years. I've seen him tested. I know his strength, his command, his faith. And I also know the incredible confidence he has in all of you. I know this man. Yes, the work of recovery is not yet complete, but we are on our way. The journey of hope is not yet finished, but we are on our way. And the cause of change is not fully accomplished, but we are on our way. So I say to you tonight, with absolute confidence, America's best days are ahead, and yes, we are on our way. And in light of that horizon, for the values that define us, for the ideals that inspire us, there is only one choice. That choice is to move forward, boldly forward, and finish the job and re-elect President Barack Obama. God bless you all.
Here that we've turned the corner but have more work to do. We're not there yet. At times veering off script, using one of his favorite words literally quite a few times. And in one moment that really caught our attention, when the crowd booed in response to a comment about Mitt Romney, he stopped them and said no, and said, I don't think he's a bad guy. Which was a shift in tone a bit from what we've seen on the campaign trail. Talking to this crowd about how Bin Laden is dead and GM is alive, and that's been a message he's pushed on the campaign trail repeatedly as a motto he thinks this campaign should be running on. Taking some shots at the Republicans on Medicare and on debt, suggesting that the Republicans rejected the Simpson-Bowles recommendations. There'll be some pushback on that since, of course, President Obama also rejected those recommendations or failed to lead to push through a bipartisan consensus on those recommendations and then made some claims about Medicare, suggesting that the Romney-Ryan plan would result in the loss of benefits for 30 million seniors immediately. Which will also raise some eyebrows, but saying that he had a ringside seat to Barack Obama's presidency, and as Brett said earlier, vouching for the commander-in-chief's character.
Right. On the Medicare point, there will be a lot of pushback on some of those specific points. And throughout this speech, there were a couple of straw men set up when the vice president said it has never, never, ever been a good bet to bet against the American people. I don't think many people think that either party is betting against the American people. But throughout the speech, he fired up this crowd. He is better than most at getting the base really excited.
And showed genuine emotion. You could see with him, you know, he teared up a couple of times. He paid a nice tribute to the troops, and the crowd ate it up. We want to get down to our chief White House correspondent, Ed Henry, who's on the floor now. Ed.
Megan, also, he said that the recovery is not complete, but earlier said, quote, America has turned the corner. We will see tomorrow when we get another jobs report whether or not that is backed up. He also talked a lot about the auto bailout. What is that about? It's about two key battlegrounds, Ohio and Michigan, where that really matters. It also is about contrasting what he was saying about the president standing up for the middle class and trying to contrast that with Mitt Romney and Bain Capital. The president has now had three character witnesses, his wife, the First Lady, Mrs. Obama, then President Clinton last night, now Vice President Biden. Bottom line is the task for the president next is to basically come out here and woo those small number of undecided voters to give him four more years. How does he do it? One of the lines tonight that he uses, he says, government programs are not the only solution to problems. But we should point out, tonight is the first anniversary that Solyndra went bankrupt. It would be difficult for him to make that case.
We should point out that Dick Durbin is speaking on the floor now, and after he speaks, they're going to do a video introducing the president. And you know, we have a lot we want to get to, and the fact that we're not taking his remarks has nothing to do with the contentious exchange he had with our own Brett Baer on Special Report the other night.
That Senator Durbin introduced Barack Obama in 2004. He also introduced him in 2008, and tonight he will introduce the video that then sets up the president, which we will take here on Fox News Channel. One of the things about Vice President Biden is he had some digs against Mitt Romney specifically. He went after Bain Capital and said, folks, the Bain way may bring your firm the highest profit, but it's not the way to lead your country from its highest office. That has been a theme going through how Bain Capital operated. And you saw the pushback in Tampa from Governor Romney and others saying we're going to fight aggressively on this issue. Let's bring back our panel quickly before we get to this video. Steve, your thoughts on Vice President Biden's speech?
Well, I thought there were almost two speeches. I mean, in the beginning, he was sort of soft and made the case, and he had these two examples. And I have quibbles with the arguments he made about the auto bailout, but I think he made a strong case on behalf of the president in the Osama Bin Laden section, talked about what it was like to be in the room. The second part of the speech was rank demagoguery, misleading statement after misleading statement, claims that he won't be able to back up, including one in which he suggests that Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan once bet against the American people. I think you would hear a quick response from them saying, in fact, we want to empower the American people and get government out of their way. You're the one who wants to make the American people more dependent on government.
Juan?
Well, I had a different view. One, I thought that the speech was very slow, and I'm not sure that was to my taste off the bat. I wanted him to have a little more passion and drive going out the box. I thought 40 minutes, it felt it had its moments, but of dragging. But, you know, the point that he was making about values and vision differing between Obama and Romney, very well done. I think that much like Bill Clinton in terms of a substantive approach to the American people, you know, Joe Biden's thing is he's average Joe. He's the Joe from Scranton. I think in that way he was very successful, very persuasive tonight.
Brett.
You know, he spoke with a certain conviction. And it's always difficult to assess while watching in the hall, even though we can see TV screens, how something is playing on television. But it did seem to me that for much of it, at the times which roused the audience so much, he seemed to be shouting. And he seemed to be angry. And anger is something you have to deal with very carefully on television. And if you come through, as it seems to me he may have to many people tonight, as an angry, angry politician, I'm not sure that goes down well. I'm not sure that makes the case effectively. So that would be my thought about it.
Brett, let me ask you, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, Brett.
What about we heard from both Senator Kerry and Vice President Biden, the tribute to the troops specifically.
That was an opening left wide by the fact that Mitt Romney did not mention that in his speech. Now, there was plenty said about it in Tampa generally, but that was an opening that they took advantage of, and it was politically shrewd of them to do so.
What do you make of the message now we heard tonight? We, of course, 4 years ago is hope and change. And tonight we hear from the vice president a slightly different message of our journey of hope is not yet finished, asking for permission to let us finish the job. Is that, you know, we're not done yet. Is that what we're likely to hear from the president, Juan?
We've heard it now from Bill Clinton. I think we've heard it from many other speakers that they feel that they're in the middle of a journey. And they're saying to the American people, the president is not to be judged on this four-year period. So I think that's right. And this business about optimism and saying that America's in decline. Again, more optimism from these Democrats today than I've been hearing from Republicans.
That image of like the roulette wheel, and you know, it's like America, not America, and suggesting that the Republican team has got its chips on the ladder. Are people going to buy that? Quickly,
yeah,
Steve.
No, I think it's really a long thing to say.
Let's listen in to this video introducing the President of the United States making his pitch for re-election.
We've been through a lot together. We've known tough times before. What carries us through? And helps us endure? What are the qualities so essential to us and the leaders who have occupied this office?
He did some things knowing that they wouldn't be popular in the short run that would lay the foundation for recovery. No other country in the world would give up the capacity to manufacture cars if it had. And so he did what the government's supposed to do in a case like that.
Do not rescue the automobile industry. I mean, it was overwhelming. Look at the polling number.
A country in the midst of a financial crisis that no one really, you know, knew the depths of the challenges that were coming. I think he had a sense.
My grandparents came out of the Depression. They knew what it was like for people not to have work. We all understand work as something more than just a paycheck. What gives you dignity? It gives you a sense of purpose.
He said, you guys got to work together and come up, and everybody's got to have some skin in the game here. You got to have a give up. You got to modernize the automobile industry.
Everybody said, ah, it's never going to work. Well, guess what?
80,000 more people working in the car business than we did before the restructuring was passed.
They're middle-class jobs. People can raise a family on a decent wage.
We've gone from an economy that was shedding jobs to one that's consistently creating jobs at all sectors. Every night, he's up until 1, 2 o'clock in the morning with his big stack of briefing books, and he reads the letters he gets from people all over America. They are, as he put it, some of the most informative pieces of material that he gets that keeps him grounded. And anyone who has kids know that the truth is, no matter what you do, your kids still think that they are the most important people in the room. So we sit around the dinner table, and he's the last person to be asked, oh, yeah, how was your day, Dad? You know, I mean, really, he's an afterthought.
He never starts a conversation by saying, what's the best political decision here? What'll help us the most? Never.
So he wasn't going to back out just because it got hard, just because it didn't poll well. That's just never been who he is, and it's certainly not how he will ever govern this country.
When my mom got cancer, she wasn't a wealthy woman, and it pretty much drained all her resources.
Watching your mother die of something that could have been prevented, that's a tough thing to deal with.
The reason he pushed ahead, knowing that there could be horrible political consequences for him, just as were for me, is that health care costs have gone up 3 times the rate of inflation. This is a huge economic issue because we spend 17.5% of our income on health care.
Anybody who gets medical care, you hundreds of thousands of dollars. You know, imagine working class mom opening up that kind of bill, you know? With a, you know, somebody sending that to her with a straight face. That understanding of that kind of reality for millions of Americans drove him to make sure that this legislation got passed. It takes a conscious effort to stay connected with what's going on in people's lives.
This was a matter of principle for him. He ran on it, he said he was going to do it, and he did it.
You hire the president to make the calls when no one else can do it. He had to decide. That's one thing George Bush said that was right. The president is the decider in chief.
We were only about 50% sure that Bin Laden was in that compound. But I had 100% confidence in our Navy SEALs.
I sat in that room with him when we were getting feeds on what was going on at the time. He sat there resolute, concerned, just watching. Got him.